Time for another board game review, and this time we have the game Tournament at Camelot. This was sent to me by WizKids, and is created by Ken Shannon, Karen Boginski, and Jody Barbesi. In Tournament at Camelot, you play as a legendary character, battling opponents with weapon cards, arrows, swords, deception, sorcery, and even alchemy. The more you injure your opponents, the better you fare in the tournament. However, even the most injured characters can make a complete comeback with the grace of godsend cards and the aid of their special companions. This trick-taking game ends when one opponent has been injured to the point of death. The player with the most health is then declared the tournament victor. Let me show you how to play. So the object of the game is to be the player with the most health at the end of the game. This is achieved by injuring your opponents with weapon cards more than they injure you. Every player receives a protagonist card, like here we have Morgan Le Fay, and a companion card. Morgan Le Fay's companion is the Scabbard. Every protagonist has a power, so Morgan's power here is whenever you play a poisoned weapon card, the highest card played loses the melee, and those powers can be used at any time. The Scabbard, her companion, can only be used after this threshold is met, in this case 200 health. So companions will be used most likely later in the game. These health cards keep track of how much health you have. You can start from robust, go to stable, eventually go from feeble to crippled if you are not doing so hot. And then you have your weapons cards. You got four suits. You have sorcery, deception, arrows, and swords. You can think of these as like the suits of a regular playing card deck. They all have numbers that represent their different strengths. And some of the cards are poisoned. They have a little skull and crossbones on them, and these do extra damage. Every standard card is worth 5 injury points, and every poisoned card is worth 10 injury points. Alchemy cards can stand in for any basic weapon suit, but there are special rules for playing them, but basically they're like wild cards, and they're worth 5 injury points each. And then you have sorcerer cards, like Merlin and the Sorcerer's Apprentice. These cards are wild, so when you play them, you assign a specific suit and number value. Merlin is a whopping 25 injury points, while the Sorcerer's Apprentice is only 5. Godsend cards are cards given to the players with the least amount of health, and they are special items like the drinking cup. You can draw 3 new godsend cards and choose one to use in the upcoming tourney round. Equipment for knights and horses. After you tally and score your weapon hits, take 2 of those weapon hit cards to use in the next tourney round. So you have like many different sort of abilities you can have depending on the equipment you get. So to start the game, everyone gets their protagonist and their companion card, and you put the companion card under the protagonist card, and you leave this threshold open for view so that when you do have it, you can know when to pull it out and use the companion. But everyone gets their own protagonist. Everybody starts at 400 health, so you can use a little heart marker just to mark your health for that. And then every player is dealt 12 cards. The remaining weapon cards that are not used are placed on the table as the weapons draw deck, because some protagonists and godsend cards require you to draw additional weapons, so not all the weapon cards will be used in a single round. Now, the player to the left of the dealer always plays the first weapon card of the tourney round, and all opponents must follow suit if they are able, or they can play a Merlin or Sorcerer's Apprentice card. So let's say player one starts with a deception card. Then if you have a deception card, you have to play it, unless you have a Merlin or Sorcerer's Apprentice card. So let's say player two does this, player three does this, and let's say player four doesn't have deception. If they want, they could use a Merlin card if they have it, and play that and decide, oh, I'm gonna make it, you know, 2 deception or something like that. Now, if you're unable to follow suit and you don't have a Merlin or Sorcerer's Apprentice card, you have to play an alchemy card if you have it. And alchemy cards match the lead suit. So if you had this alchemy card, you'd have to play it. Now, if you can't follow suit and you don't have a sorcerer card or an alchemy card, then you can play any card from your hand and play it face down into the discard pile. You immediately sustain 5 injury points for the shame of not being able to participate in the battle. So if player 4 had no cards that could be played, they could play, I don't know, this card, but play it face down and get 5 injury. You can only lead with an alchemy card if that's the only suit left in your hand. If you have other cards, you have to play those first. If someone leads with alchemy, then everyone can play any card. Now, before determining who wins this melee, if any cards are equal value, you flip them face down. This includes Merlin and Sorcerer's Apprentice cards that share a value with other cards. So let's say player 4 played a Merlin and decided that they were going to have their value be 11, okay? Then these two cards would actually be flipped face down, and these cards are not counted during the melee. But let's say we had a normal round of just all deception cards. Now, Whoever played the lowest value weapons card loses the melee, and that player gathers all the weapons card and places them in their weapon hits pile on the table in their play area. If anyone couldn't follow suit and discarded their card face down, that card is not collected by the loser. Only cards that were played in the melee get taken by the losing player. Now let's say all the cards were face down because of equal values or something like that. Then what you would do is not take them, you would set them aside as injury for the next round. Now, whoever lost the melee takes all the cards, and they play the next card for the next melee. So if you've played trick-taking games like Hearts or something like that, it's a very similar concept of playing cards, take the cards, and the next player plays another card, and you match suit if you can. Now, after everyone has played all of their cards, the tourney round is over, and everyone counts up their weapon hits. And remember, these regular cards are 5 damage, these poison cards are 10 damage, Merlins are 25, and the Sorcerer's Apprentice are 5. So you count up all those injury points. So this would be 25, 30, 40, 45, 50, 55, 60. This would be 60 injury points total. Then what you do is you move your health token down the appropriate amount. This would go from 400 to 340. After everyone has calculated their health, then you look and see if anyone has passed their threshold of use. So if Morgan Le Fay's player was below 200 health, then they could start using the scabbard and that power in battle. The most injured player then gathers and shuffles all the weapon cards, and they will become the dealer for the next tourney round. And then you distribute godsend cards before you start the next tourney round. So in Tournament of Camelot, divine help is always available to the most injured players, and these godsend cards provide players with additional special powers that may be used during a tourney round. As the game progresses, the number of players who receive a godsend card grows. And here they have a chart for you. For 3 to 4 players, in the tourney round 1, only the most injured player receives a card. In round 2, 2 most injured, and so on. And different rules for 5 to 6 players. As the game goes on, more players will receive godsend cards. Whoever the healthiest player never gets a godsend card. Now, what you do is you take the godsend card, and you flip the first 2 cards face up. So here we got the equipment for knights and horses and the drinking cup. Now, the most injured player can select a godsend card. They can pick one of these 2, or they can pick one at random. So let's say they pick one at random. They have the beast. You may opt out of 1 melee, meaning 1 hand, during the tourney round. You must announce this before you play your weapon card. Now let's say a player 2 picks one and they pick the drink cup. Then you replace that card with a new card face up. Here we have the Fisher King. You may remove up to 3 poison weapon cards that have been played by you or an opponent in a melee. Now, any player who is 100 or more points behind the healthiest player can get another godsend card. And whoever is 200 or more points receives an additional godsend card as well. Any remaining face-up godsend cards after everyone's picked their cards are discarded. Now these godsend cards last for the next tourney round, and after the tourney round is done, you don't have them anymore. And so this is basically a trick-taking game where you're trying to play high cards and not play the lowest card, and the more cards you get, the more damage you get. And with special abilities, that kind of can give you advantages in certain areas. So whenever a player goes all the way down to 0, that's when the game ends, and whoever is the healthiest player is the winner. And that's how you play.
So I have very mixed feelings about this game. Let me talk about what I like first. First of all, the art is really cool. I like this kind of, like, classic, like, sort of look to it. Like, it's a very fun theme, and the art is a very nice fit for that theme. And trick-taking itself as a mechanic, I actually really enjoy a lot. It's fun playing, like, you know, trying to strategize using the right suit and the right numbers so that you don't get cards. It's always fun when you're doing that in any trick-taking game. And the powers are fun, but I think they are very unbalanced. Whether it's the character's powers or the godsend cards, I felt like it was way, way too unbalanced in terms of how powerful some of these powers could be. For example, there's a character named Sir Gawain. And Sir Gawain, whenever he plays a deception card and loses, he doesn't lose. Basically, all the weapon cards played remain on the table and are passed to the player who loses the next melee. So he's basically immune if he plays a deception card. In a trick-taking game, being immune basically to one suit of card is insane. And then there are godsend cards like Fanfare, where before you can make one opponent lead every melee of that round, which sucks. I mean, if you have not great cards and you have to play the lead card every single time, that's rough. This card, the Flaming Sword, what it does is, at the end of the turning round, all their weapon hits are doubled. So if you were going to take, let's say, 150 damage, you're going to take 300 damage now. Ooh, that seems a little rough to me. The chessboard, you always play the last card, which is a huge advantage. And the dragon, you can make one player just play with their whole hand exposed, meaning everyone can see their cards, so they basically can't plan anything. Those are just a sampling of some cards that I think are just ridiculous. I mean, yeah, powers are fun, but in a trick-taking game where, like, one turning round can be, like, a huge difference, making someone, like, play with all their cards face up or making them take double damage for a round is brutal, and I don't think it's actually very well balanced in that regard. I also actually really don't like that only part of the deck is used in the game. In trick-taking, I think a lot of the strategy is, like, knowing what came out first. Like, okay, these swords or these deception cards were played before, so I know that this is the next highest card or whatever, so I should be safe if I play this. That is part of the strategy of trick-taking games. But with a random assortment of cards, you have no idea if some of those cards are in the stack and, like, are not going to be played, or some of them are in someone's hands. You don't know, and there's a lot less planning you can do with the trick-taking. So again, I have very mixed feelings, because gameplay-wise, it's fun. It's fun doing trick-taking. That's always going to be fun. But powers are, while fun in their own way, can just completely blast the opposition with, depending on what you get. There's a character that can have just two godsend cards as their companion and their protagonist. That's their powers, that they have a godsend card in replacement. And if you get godsend cards on top of those, you have, like, maybe like four godsend cards in a round. It's insane. And maybe that's what they wanted with this game. Maybe they want it to be kind of like a wild, kind of like party game where just anything can happen and the strategy can sometimes be thrown out the window and you can just have super overpowered turns. But I felt that it was honestly a bit of a detriment. I think that there's room for powers in games, and a lot of games use powers very well and very balanced, and this game is not one of them. If you don't mind that chaos and the risk of being super overpowered, then it's a pretty fun trick-taking game. But if you're like me and want more fairness amongst all players, like with more balanced character powers and, I don't know, mitigating some of the godsend stuff, then I don't know. I can't recommend as much. But it's fun, but it's chaotic. And if you know that, then you might have a good time.